Good evening, everybody. As you are aware, since the last week, from every Tuesdays, we have started these five evening tutorials, which are primarily aimed at giving you away information about as to how to write answers to the theory questions. Until now, we have selected short notes. And in combinations, I suppose these will help you to answer long questions as well. Today is our second of its kind and the second module on headaches. Just a few things I wanted to share with you is that why 15 minutes? Some of you may feel that we are rushing through, but remember that questions come to you with a stipulated time frame for short notes, as one of them is going to show you. We'll have just around 15 to 18 minutes, and for a full question, maybe 45 to 60 minutes. So we want to impart you the art of finishing that subject in that limited amount of time and cover all the points necessary to score as high as possible. So that is the purpose of that. And another point is, these lectures are prepared after extensively reviewing the literature on the subject. So what is required in the exams? You can ask any question pertaining to the same. These are not for discussing any personal experiences or anecdotes. So as much as possible, we'll try and, not discuss points like those. We will answer as many questions as possible, but there are time constraints, and if some of them do not stay answered, then you can SMS me or WhatsApp me. My number is now shared between many fine groups. And then another thing is the organizing committee, Dr. Kothari and others, have prepared many WhatsApp groups with links, and the links have been relayed there. The link to join these groups will also be available in a day or two on the FINE website, which is the neurologycourses.com. In addition, many PPTs and PDFs are available for many diseases and information, so you can take help of that. I think with this, I'll begin today's module. And we all know the first topic is tax. And the talk will be delivered by Dr. Akash Chheda, who is our young dynamic neurologist who passed from JJ Hospital. And at the moment, he is working as lecturer at KM Hospital, Mumbai. He is very actively involved in the academics there. Over to you, Akash. You can begin.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. At the outset, I'd like to thank the fine group organizers for having me, giving me this opportunity, and it is really nice platform for all, especially students, to have this great learning experience. So talking about theory exams, so as sir has said, it is a 10 mark SAQ for both DM as well as DNB students. He has already given you that you need to devote a specific time to it, and you cannot exceed more than 18 to 20 minutes for each SAQ. SAQs are usually a scoring thing. They are usually specific questions which are asked, whereas long answers are usually broad, open-based, wherein the examiner has got his own set of things that you need to answer according to his way. But usually SAQs are specific, and everyone knows what to answer in it. So it is a high-scoring game. And you can cover up if you are not able to do well in your long answers. One more thing which is important is you should divide your answer paper for DM students, especially because you don't get any extra answer sheet. So for each SAQ, you will get 4 sides. I think Dr. Amit will be able to explain you how to crack theory exams very well, because he was a very high scorer in his exams. So coming to my topic today, it is of importance from both theory as well as practical point. Trigeminal autonomic cephalgia. Most of the headache which we see, which we learn during our DM training, is migraine. But this is a very important topic, and once in a while, when such patients come to you, we should not miss it, because the treatment is different and it is a treatable thing. So it is a satisfying thing to know and to practice. So this will be the heads of discussion. So whenever there is a question in your paper, you should just go through the question, and in your mind, you should always have these things, these heads under which you are going to cover that answer. So most of the questions you will have introduction, then basically you can talk about pathophysiology, clinical features, following which there'll be differential diagnosis that is investigations, and then treatment. So this basic structure remains same throughout medicine, I suppose. So even for tax, we will have this thing. The thing in the bracket is the scoring, which I think is getting more and more objective as the exams are getting advanced. So for this topic, I think this should be the grading, or this can be the diversifications. So I will want to elaborate on each of this. So whenever such topic comes like TAC as your question, it is important to know broadly what is TAC. Neurology being a vast subject, it is not possible to read and remember everything. So whenever you are seeing patient or whenever you are trying to read, you should try to understand it conceptually so that it remains with you for a longer time. This happens in exam that we are so tensed up, we may not even understand what are the diseases which will come under TAC. It had so happened that sometimes people forget cluster headache is a type of TAC. So you should always try to remember the broad categories first and then try to go deep into the subject. So that is very important for passing and for scoring in exam and even in future life. So trigeminal autonomic cephalgia, why all the diseases are grouped into this? That is because they share few common things. So it is a primary headache disorder and it is a group of primary headache disorders. So it has few entities within it. They share common features that they all have pain in the trigeminal nerve distribution and associated autonomic features, which are ipsilateral cranial autonomic features of lacrimation, conjunctival injection, nasal congestion, and rhinorrhea. So which are these entities? They are cluster headache, paroxysmal hemicrania, sunk suna, that is short lasting unilateral neuralgiform headache with conjunctival injection and tearing, and hemicrania continua. What is new in this classification is chronic cluster headache has now been defined as remission period lasting less than 3 months. Previously it was thought it is lasting less than 1 month and in a year. So in a year, if the there is remission period of less than 3 months, you call it as a chronic cluster headache. And hemicrania continua is now defined as a TAC. So initially it was other primary headache. Now it has been included in the category of TAC. Again, we will talk about chronic cluster and chronic paroxysmal hemicrania in the future slides. So coming to the crux of the topic, which everyone wants to know, and many of us have seen this table lot many times, but we tend to forget it or we tend to not remember it. But believe me, this is the most important table and this is the take home slide. So how do you differentiate this? Sex predilection, usually cluster and sunk suna are more common in males, whereas paroxysmal hemicrania and hemicrania continua have a female predisposition. Distribution of headache, usually it is in the V1 distribution of trigeminal nerve, that is orbit and temple. It can be hemicranial as in hemicrania continua. What is the quality of pain and how severe it is? So in all of this, the pain can be severe. We mistake that cluster is most severe, but I think all of this can look similar and can have the same severity if we are to judge them only on severity. Quality wise, they may differ. That cluster is having a stabbing kind of quality. Paroxysmal hemicrania has a throbbing or boring stabbing nature. Sunk suna are mostly described as a burning pain or sharp shooting pain, whereas hemicrania continua also, people will tell you that they have some pressure kind of thing, they feel something is pressing, there's a throbbing kind of headache. Frequency and duration, these are the criteria on which you will want to differentiate each one of these entities. So cluster, remember the frequency is 1 to 8 per day and each will last for 15 minutes to 3 hours. whereas paroxysmal hemicrania, the frequency is 5 to 50 per day and they last for 2 to 30 minutes. So any headache which is lasting for less than 15 minutes cannot be clustered. It can be paroxysmal hemicrania though. Any attack which is for more than 10 times per day cannot be clustered. It can be paroxysmal hemicrania though. That is the way you tend to differentiate when the patient gives you the history that I have headache which is with a frequency of 10 per day, each episode lasting for only few minutes, maybe 10 minutes. Then you are knowing that you are dealing not with cluster but with paroxysmal hemicrania. Similarly, if the patient says that the headache is lasting for 1 to 2 hours, you know it is not paroxysmal hemicrania and it can be cluster headache. For Sang Suna, the attacks are very small lasting, usually seconds to few minutes, that is maximum of 10 minutes, but the frequency can be very high. They can have attacks to the range of 100 per day. Whereas hemicrania continua has a continuous headache. There is a baseline headache and there can be an exacerbation. The exacerbation can last from 30 minutes to 3 days. Now again, this episodic to chronic thing. So usually cluster headache is episodic phenomenon. Episode of cluster headache. What is an episode? Episode is many cluster headaches occurring in an episode. So the episode usually lasts for 3 months. By definition, it can last for 7 days to 1 year. But usually it lasts for 3 months, then the patient goes into remission. The remission will be for more than 3 months. So it is episodic variety. If the remission is less than 3 months, we will call it as chronic cluster headache. Whereas in case of paroxysmal hemicrania, the chronic variety supersedes the episodic one. Chronic again is episodes which are lasting for more than, the remission is less than 3 months. And episode or the attack period lasts for more than 1 year. And in between there is remission which is not sustained for 3 months. So you will call it as chronic paroxysmal hemicrania. Similarly, sunk and hemicrania continua is usually continuous. So hemicrania continua has predisposition for being chronic. Again, the most important thing is periodicity. I think this is due to the hypothalamus involvement in cluster, that the patient can actually know when he is going to get an attack. Sometimes patient gets up if it is at night and anticipates that now is the time that I'm going to get a headache, and he may reach the doctor before he gets a headache. Sometimes they get benefit with oxygen, so they always are in that place during that time and wanting to have that treatment because it is a severe headache. And usually in all of this, the patient will be restless. Unlike migraine, wherein patient will want a calm, serene environment and not want to be disturbed. Triggers are also very important. This periodicity is not seen in any other type except cluster. So they are all triggered by alcohol basically, and nitroglycerin, which is a vasodilator. Smoke, high altitude, strong smells can also be a trigger for cluster headache. Most of them will tell that within taking the alcohol, within 1 hour I get the attack, or even during while taking the alcohol, my attack starts. So it is a pointer towards one of the attack. Neck movement precipitating an event is more with paroxysmal hemicrania. And tactile stimulation, tactile trigger, like in trigeminal neuralgia, is or can be seen with Sang and Suna. We all know that cluster headache, acute therapy, sumatriptan or triptans have a role. They can also benefit paroxysmal hemicrania in 20%. And indomethacin has been included in the diagnostic criteria for paroxysmal hemicrania and hemicrania continua. In fact, it is said that good dose of indomethacin for 2 weeks with no relief, you have to reconsider your diagnosis. So again, in the lower picture, I have tried to depict the same thing. Even if you don't remember the exact duration or exact episodes frequency, you should remember that seconds to minutes is sunk, minutes is paroxysmal hemicrania, hours is cluster, months is hemicrania continua. Frequency for paroxysmal hemicrania is 5 to 50. Just remember that much and I think you'll be able to reproduce it in the exam. Coming to the more complex part, pathophysiology, which we all fear, but I think it has been very nicely given in continuum from where I have taken this picture and from where I have taken this pathophysiology. Ideally, it is said that the pathophysiology is not completely known. That is the reason we find it difficult to treat Sang Suna cluster. Sometimes sometimes patients don't improve despite our treatment because we don't know what is causing it. But whatever we know so far is there are three systems which have been involved. That is a pain system, cranial autonomic system, and the posterior hypothalamus. these three systems don't act independently, but they are connected to each other. So the pain system is our old trigeminovascular system, also the culprit in migraine. And the molecules responsible are CGRP, that is calcitonin, growth-related peptide, substance P, PACAP-38 is pituitary adenylate cyclase activating peptide, and neurokinin A. For autonomic system, you have reduced sympathetic activation and increased parasympathetic activity. That is parasympathetic paroxysmal activity, parasympathetic paroxysmal discharge. So this term, parasympathetic paroxysms, is very important. And you can underline, you can highlight such things when you are writing. Again, the way I have made my presentation is like writing an answer. So the things written on left and the diagram drawn on the right both depict the same thing. So if you are able to draw a diagram, if you're able to communicate the examiner via this diagram, it carries more weightage and it is looking more simpler, more beneficial to the reader. You are in a concise way giving them whatever is important and whatever is known. So again, I will say that there is trigemino autonomic connection, trigeminal autonomic reflex. There is hypothalamus trigeminal connection, hypothalamus autonomic connection. So all these things are connected, and treatment on any one center will help and have an impact on all the three. So in fact, cluster headache can be treated by stimulation of occipital nerve, that is greater occipital nerve, which is part of trigeminovascular system. We know it is not in trigeminal distribution, but there is a pain matrix. There is this trigeminal area, trigeminovascular area, wherein occipital and trigeminal afferents meet. So modulating that part can also help in trigeminal pain. Okay, the sphenopalatine ganglion stimulation, which acts through superior salivatory nucleus. So even stimulating that can help treat cluster headache and posterior hypothalamus, as we have seen that periodicity and many things, the emotional quotient, the agitation can be attributed to hypothalamus, restlessness. Some people think that the pain is so severe, that can be also an attributing thing. Also, we know that oxygen is known to decrease the firing of cells in trigemino cervical complex, helping in the treatment of TAC. And sectioning trigeminal nerve can also cause pain freedom. So it's a complicated thing, but if you remember three systems, pain, autonomic system, and hypothalamus, the substance molecules for each one of them, which is causing or responsible for pain. And if you try to help the patient with those substance modulations, you can find a treatment for it. Coming to the another important part, that is differential diagnosis. How do you differentiate TAC from migraine? So migraine is also can also be severe, but migraine, usually the pain takes time to escalate. Migraine attacks can be long lasting. Usually cluster will last for a few hours, but migraine can last for days. Again, migraine, the patient wants a calm environment. Patient does not like being called, or patient will not be restless and agitated. Second thing, hypnic headache. So hypnic headaches are again nocturnal headaches. They do not occur during daytime, and they respond very well to coffee and indomethacin. So hypnic headache is also a diagnosis of exclusion, but the severity of pain is not like that of TAC. Secondary headaches like angle closure glaucoma sometimes can cause redness and continuous pain, which can be very severe. So in that case, you can palpate the eye and you can feel that it is hard, and the intraocular pressure monitoring or measurement will give you the diagnosis. Tolosa Hunt is another important condition which one should remember when one is considering the diagnosis of TAC, but it can involve the cavernous sinus and have cranial neuropathies associated. Headache precedes, and they are very steroid responsive. So MRI is important, and I'll discuss in my future slide that in all cases of TAC, we need a baseline MRI. Paratrigeminal neuralgia. Again, this is V1 trigeminal neuralgia with oculosympathetic involvement. Patients have Horner's syndrome without sweating because it goes through the ICA. This is post-ganglionic Horner's. So this is also a diagnosis, and usually sometimes it can be idiopathic, but something along the course of the ICA can result in this, like ICA dissection or ICA aneurysm is responsible for paratrigeminal neuralgia. Temporal arteritis, age more than 60, jaw claudication helps you to differentiate high ESR. So it tells you that, yeah, it is not TAC. Trigeminal neuralgia, it is basically V3, triggered pain, can be confused with Sung Suna. Sometimes even Sung patient have some benefit with CBZ, but CBZ response in trigeminal neuralgia is extremely good. So response to treatment can also be considered as a part to revise your initial diagnosis of TAC. I think seniors in the discussion will be able to guide you more, because these are very practical things, and as you see patients, as you experience patients, you make your own judgment and you realize how difficult or how important it is to never miss these conditions, especially paroxysmal hemicrania and hemicrania continua. Another symptomatic cluster headache cause can be neoplasm like pituitary tumor, which can bring in the periodicity. And we have already seen dissection, AV malformation, moya, subclavian steel can have pictures similar to TAC. Obstructive sleep apnea can make one get up from sleep and have this kind of headaches. So baseline investigation is MRI brain, and whenever you are doing it, you should do it with cavernous and pituitary cuts to rule out Tolosa Hunt and pituitary tumor. If patient is not improving with the treatment, then you should consider MR angiography, ESR, dental reference, ENT reference, and ophthal reference, angle closure, glaucoma, dental. We have seen that impacted tooth, and ENT for sinusitis. You can also contemplate sleep study, pituitary hormone study, if you have a doubt regarding OSA or pituitary tumor. Coming to the treatment part, so there are, it is always good if you can write like acute treatment, transitional treatment, preventive treatment, and in cases of refractory cluster. So for acute treatment, we give oxygen. So it is through a non-rebreathing mask. It has to be 100% oxygen at the rate of 12 to 15 liters per minute for at least 20 minutes. So whatever has been highlighted is the thing we tend to forget. So these are the things which you need to make notes and which you need to revise or look once before the exam. Or else you have to see a patient with whom you can treat, and then you will never forget this. So triptans also, we know that they are useful, but oral triptans, because the severity of pain, we prefer to give them via an invasive way, either subcute or intranasal. So you should remember the dose, that is maximum 12 milligram of sumatriptan or 40 milligram per day of intranasal way. Zolmitriptan maximum 10 milligram we can give. We can repeat this doses at the interval of 1 hour or so. And even vagus nerve stimulation is what I was not knowing before the presentation, but now I know that even that can be used for the treatment of TAC, for acute attack, like in epilepsy. So for transitional treatment, what is transition? That is when you are wanting to have some time, when the preventive or the prophylactic treatment takes time to build up, like in migraine, you say them that this therapy will take 15 days to start its action. At that time, you can give an oral steroid course, but you need to taper over 3 weeks. And 2 to 3 courses per year is what is recommended. So it is ideal when there is a brief headache cycle. Suppose a patient has a cluster headache, I said usually it will last for 3 months, but usually if the history is of only 1 month or 15 days, you can use a short steroid course. Greater occipital nerve block has already been described and is very useful for the transitional treatment. And preventive treatment is verapamil. You should look at the heart block and ECG monitoring and gradual titration of the dose to the maintenance dose of 480 to 720 milligram in 3 divided doses. Others like lithium, topiramate, and baclofen can also be used, but lithium needs monitoring of the drug level. And we as neurologists are not very comfortable using lithium rather than the other agents which are mentioned. Another refractory cluster headache, again, you can do neuromodulation, which is new to neurology. So sphenopalatine ganglion stimulation, occipital nerve stimulation, and deep brain stimulation of posterior hypothalamus have found a promising role for these patients. Coming to the treatment of paroxysmal hemicrania, as we've already seen, indomethacin, start with 25 milligram 3 times a day, up titrate it to 75 milligram. You can go till 75 milligram 3 times a day in 1 to 2 weeks. Then stay at 75 milligram 3 times a day for 2 weeks before calling that the indomethacin is not working. Only side effect which is of concern is gastric. So if you are able to manage the acidity, and if the patient is able to tolerate, then I think we can give justice to this drug. Others like COX-2 inhibitors, verapamil, topiramate, melatonin. Melatonin, again, it is due to the hypothalamus connection in the pathophysiology that has found role in all these diseases. Sphenopalatine ganglion and greater occipital nerve blocks. for Sang Suna, the drug of choice is lamotrigine. You need to titrate it gradually. So during the transition, you may use blocks. You may use IV lignocaine. And those are things. But you have to go very gradually, avoiding rash. 100 to 200 milligram per day can sometimes have good effect on patient. But Sang Suna patients are usually the most resistant patients, the most difficult type to treat. Hemicrania continuous, AMS, pH, and endomethacin works wonder. So with this, I think we can stop or try to cover maximum. During the presentation and throughout the preparation, I would like to thank Dr. Pujari, who has been really helping throughout the preparation of talk. He even to the extent gave me the reading material from where I can prepare the talk. So he's taking great efforts, and I think this is of great help to all the students. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Chheda. This was extensive and very well put through all the topic. You've covered everything, really. Not skipped many points to the question. Very nice. We're just extending a bit of time, so I would move on to the next talk, which is IIH. Will be done by Dr. Batra, who was a gold medalist at KGMC Lucknow, and he's done his movement disorder fellowship at NIMHANS, and at present he's the young neurologist practicing at Nagpur. So I request Dr. Dhruv to begin his presentation on IIH.
Point, extremely thankful to Dr. Pujari for giving me the opportunity to present on this topic. And I'm extremely thankful to all the participants and my co-speakers as well who have joined us today evening. Thank you very much. So my topic is idiopathic intracranial hypertension. All right, so now the layout of the talk. So this is for our PGs who are preparing for the exams, and it contains these aspects on which I will talk today. And there are some must-read aspects. So the talk has been layered in such a way that apart from writing an answer, it will help you to manage a patient practically in your OPD or your wards, and maybe in your practice as well, because what you learn during your residency is what you practice. So the talk would have an introduction, pathophysiology, clinical features, diagnostic criteria, differential diagnosis, investigations, management, prognosis, and some must-read aspects which might be important in your VIVA and practical exams. So introduction, this was formerly known as pseudotumor cerebri or BIH, but now it is known as IIH. So what you need to remember is it is a syndrome of increased intracranial pressure of unclear etiology. And the important aspects I have highlighted in the broad terms. So it is seen in obese women of childbearing age. And if you can see the data, in women who are obese and of childbearing age, it is seen in about 12 to 20 per 100,000 people per year. But in the general population is only 0.5 to 2. So you can see that there's a lot of disparity between the occurrence of this, the incidence of this illness. And so whenever you see an obese lady of childbearing age with symptoms suggestive of a headache and maybe raised ICP, you should always suspect IIH. And obviously, this is now expected to rise in line with the worldwide obesity epidemic. And remember, most importantly, IIH is a diagnosis of exclusion. So you cannot diagnose IIH unless you have ruled out other etiologies of increased intracranial pressure. Okay, so just let us clarify some terminologies before we go further. So in some terminologies, what is a typical IIH? So typical IIH is somebody who is a female of childbearing age with a BMI of greater than 30 kg per meter square. So an obese female of childbearing age. Atypical IIH is somebody obviously who is not fitting into typical IIH. So not female, not of childbearing age, and who has a BMI below 30. So what is important is when you get somebody of atypical IIH, you should always and always do a more in-depth investigation to rule out other underlying causes. So if you get a male who is young and who is thinly built and who has papilledema and headache, always think of something other than IIH. What is fulminant IIH? Patients who meet the criteria for a precipitous decline in visual function within 4 weeks of diagnosis. So within 4 weeks of diagnosis of IIH, If they have a significant decline in visual function, you call them as fulminant IH. This is important because the management of this patient is completely different from what you do with a typical IH. And what is IH in ocular remission? So these are patients who are diagnosed as IH, but now the papilledema has resolved, which means that the vision is no longer at risk and you just need to treat their headache. So these are a little less on the risk strata. So I'll not go too much into detail. This is what you need to do when you're writing an answer. You just need to draw this flow chart. It's a simple diagram of the pathogenesis of the IH. If you can see my pointer. So what you need to do is, you need to know that what can increase the ICP or the intracranial pressure. So what you need to know is, it is the CSF. So if there is an increased CSF production, it can cause raised ICP. Another simple thing which does not need any rocket science is a reduced drainage of CSF. More CSF getting produced and lesser of this, there is an increased venous sinus pressure. So when there is increased venous sinus pressure, the absorption of the CSF across the arachnoid granulations will not happen because there is a back pressure which is pushing it away from the absorption. To compound matters, if you get a venous sinus stenosis, the venous pressure will again rise, thereby reducing the absorption of CSF. Sometimes it has been studied that when you have a lot of obesity, it has been found that obese females have a lot of IH. So the reason has been given as the effect of adipokines, which are released from the adipose tissue. That is one reason. And sometimes female sex hormones can also predispose to raised ICP. There is some study on increased inflammatory and thrombophilic factors. There is some mention of impaired lymphatic drainage. So just to summarize it in a minute, when you write the answer, draw a diagram of the brain. You show the brain, you show the choroid plexus, you show the venous sinuses, and then you can just divide it into CSF, the venous pressure, and the inflammatory markers. So increased CSF production, reduced drainage, increased venous sinus pressure causing reduced absorption, and increase in inflammatory factors along with impaired lymphatic drainage. Not very difficult, three factors: CSF, venous sinus pressure, and lymphatic drainage along with inflammatory markers. So sometimes there is a terminology which has been used as pseudotumor cerebri. So it has been used for secondary causes. Now, I'll not go into much details, but you should know that these are the secondary causes that you need to rule out before diagnosing IH. As I told you, IH is a diagnosis of exclusion. So you'd rule out history of antibiotics, hormonal factors, excess of vitamin A and retinoids, and other drugs such as the OC pills, corticosteroids, lithium and cyclosporin. Sometimes we miss out on these disorders. We always ask for drug history, we ask for tetracycline, we ask for thyroid and other things, but we miss out. Anemia, very common. Addison's and Cushing's, disorders of adrenal gland and steroids. Patients who have Down syndrome and Turner syndrome. So next time you see a patient with Down syndrome complaining of headache, don't miss IH. Renal failure and autoimmune disorders such as SLE and Sjogren's syndrome. So this is a big slide, busy slide, but you should remember that always when you're dealing with IH, you should rule out systemic conditions apart from iatrogenic causes such as drugs and hormones. All right. So I'll just quickly go through the symptoms. Now we all know that there is headache, which is the most common. We know that there is TVO, which is transient visual obscurations. We know there is tinnitus. So these are the most common symptoms you get with IH. But what we usually miss out is back pain, 53%. It is nearly as much as tinnitus or as much as photophobia. Dizziness is commonly seen. Neck pain. Visual loss or burning is common. Cognitive disturbances, but what we miss out is radicular pain. So sometimes patients with IH can have diffuse neck pain, radicular pain, along with papilledema. So it fits in. I mean, you should not neglect this as a non-specific symptom. So just to complete the list, last of which is horizontal diplopia. So this is the list of symptoms in order of decreasing frequency: headache, transient visual obscurations, tinnitus, back pain, dizziness, neck pain, visual blurring, cognitive disturbances, radicular pain, and diplopia. Now, I'll quickly go through the signs. Papilledema. We all know IH presents with papilledema. It is usually bilateral and symmetric. You can have retinal hemorrhages, cotton wool spots, and exudates. If your patient has been untreated with papilledema for a long time, then he can have a progressive and irreversible vision loss with optic atrophy. Patients can also have sixth and seventh nerve palsies, and these are the false localizing signs. Visual field defects. Now, I'll just spend a minute on this because what happens is in visual field defects, we tend to check it clinically, but nowadays the management has come to the point wherein when you quantify the visual field, so the quantification is done in terms of mean deviation. So you are given a score when you send them for a perimetry and you do a visual field defect, you are given a score, let's say -5, -10. So the more the number in negative, more is the visual field defect. So let's say somebody has a visual field defect of -5 mean deviation and somebody has -10. So it means somebody with -10 has more amount of visual field impairment as a result of IIH. So this will, I'll come to it later when we are discussing management. A brief word about IIH without papilledema. So somebody can ask you, Viva, do you get IIH without papilledema? Yes, you can get. Why? Because sometimes if there is an anatomic compartmentalization of the subarachnoid space around the optic nerve, which means the pressure from the brain is not getting transmitted to the retrolaminar portion of the optic nerve. There is some barrier in between. So you might not get papilledema. Or let's say somebody has a CSF rhinorrhea or otorrhea and he's leaking CSF. So in spite of the presence of IIH, you may not get a papilledema. So these are the two important things you should remember in IIH without papilledema. Anatomical compartmentalization so that the pressure is not transmitted and somewhere CSF is getting leaked, so the pressure is going down and not reaching the eyes. All right. So this is the criteria that your examiner is looking for. If you write an answer on IIH, you need to write about modified DANDI criteria. It is not very difficult. It is just a name somebody gave to the criteria and you need to remember it for exam purposes. But if you go through the criteria, I think you will also agree that it's pretty logical exam except cranial nerve abnormalities. Like I said, raised IIH can cause sixth nerve palsy or seventh nerve palsy. Then neuroimaging should be normal, which means normal in the sense there should be no hydrocephalus, mass, structural lesion or meningeal enhancement or venous sinus thrombosis. And the CSF should be normal. So you don't, if you have cells and raised proteins, you should think of a diagnosis other than IIH and a raised lumbar opening pressure. So more than 25 centimeters of water in a lateral deep cubitus position means it is a raised opening pressure of CSF. So five things, A, B, C, D, E. So if A to E are satisfied and there are no secondary causes, which means you fulfill the DANDI criteria for a definite IIH, let's say you don't have a raised opening pressure. You have only A to B. Then it is a probable diagnosis. So if you have all five, it is definite. And if you have only four, it is a probable. If you don't have raised opening pressure, you go directly from definite to probable. All right. Now, we talked about IIH without papilledema. So, you remember that if there is no papilledema, then the rest of the things like B, C, D, E have to be satisfied. So, there is no papilledema. There is no A. So, you need to fulfill B, C, D, E. So, you have IIH without papilledema. And in addition to that, you need to have a bilateral sixth cranial nerve palsy, which will support an alternate, which will support the absence of papilledema. So no papilledema. So you need now bilateral sixth cranial nerve palsy to satisfy the criteria. And you need to have signs of neuroimaging signs of raised intracranial pressure. So when you don't have papilledema, remember, you need to look for cranial nerve palsy. And then you need to look for neuroimaging signs of raised ICP. I'll not go into the details. We all know what are the signs of raised ICP, empty cella, flattening of the globe, transverse venous sinus stenosis, and perioptic dilatation or the tortuosity of the optic nerve. So I'll briefly come to the differential diagnosis. What are the differential diagnosis of intracranial pressure? You have to rule out an intracranial mass. You have to rule out for the blockage of ventricular system, that is obstructive hydrocephalus. You need to look out for blockage of CSF absorption, let's say as a result of subarachnoid hemorrhage. You need to watch for obstruction of venous outflow. As I told you, if the venous outflow is obstructed, CSF will not be absorbed and there will be a raised pressure, such as CVT. Diffuse cerebral edema can also be seen following head injury. Increased CSF secretion, very rare, but you need to look for it, a choroid plexus tumor. And obviously, if it's nothing fits in, then it's idiopathic, called as IIH. sometimes you may have meningioma or a tumor which compresses on the extrinsically on the venous sinus, or you may have arterialization, which means the sinus is getting flow from the artery and hence its pressure is getting increased. So you need to look out for all this. This is the differential diagnosis that you need to rule out before labeling somebody as IH. Okay, now coming to investigation. Whenever you write an answer, when you write the investigations, it is always better to write down what is the purpose of investigation. So the purpose of investigation is, firstly, we are looking for neuroimaging and CSF evaluation. Why are we doing it? We are doing it to exclude the other etiologies. So we are ruling out structural causes and we are ruling out any infective or secondary causes in the CSF. The second line of investigation is ophthalmic investigations. You remember, all that we do in IIH is first to save the vision. Never forget, our main target in IIH is always and always vision, because once it goes and optic atrophy sets in, you can't do anything. So ophthalmic investigations are to determine the severity of vision loss and obviously to look for papilledema, because our management will depend on the severity of vision loss. And third is to look for other etiologies of disc edema. This is an often neglected part, but we should know that there are some conditions which can mimic an optic disc edema, such as optic disc drusen. It may mimic papilledema and we may end up going on a wild goose chase, ending up with nothing. It may eventually just be an optic disc drusen, which needs a maybe not that aggressive management. Now, coming to neuroimaging, we all know MRI brain is the best investigation. What we need to do is remember, whenever you have a patient who comes in with IIH, always do a venogram. So MRI brain with MR venogram to rule out CVT, especially in an atypical presentation or a fulminant. I told you, if you get a young guy who is not obese, who is thinly built, and he's a male, this is an atypical IIH. Always suspect that he's having something secondary, because your typical IIH is always an obese female of a childbearing age. All right? Never miss to do a venogram in patients suspected of IIH. And obviously, it will tell you about other signs of raised ICP, which are empty cella turcica, dilatation and tortuosity of the optic nerve sheaths, posterior globe flattening, acquired tonsillar descent below the level of foramen magnum. And you may, in the MRV, you may find stenosis in the transverse venous sinuses. Okay, so coming to CSF, CSF has a dual role. Number one, pressure. Only important points I'm going to highlight because of the lack of time. Remember, normal pressure is 10 to 20, all right? In adults. More than 25, straight away you know that the pressure is high. 20 to 25 is borderline, but you need to consider it as abnormal. But if you get other associated signs and symptoms, such as a papilledema, such as any other signs which are supporting IIH, okay? There is a history of, let's say, tetracycline, doxycycline intake, history of steroid intake, obese female, then 20 to 25 will also be abnormal. But remember, whenever you're doing a CSF in children, 28 is the upper cutoff. So less than 28 is normal. Okay. So don't label 28 centimeters of water in children as abnormal. And obviously, CSF will tell you about infectious, inflammatory, neoplastic causes. And remember, if your CSF is abnormal, increased white cell count or protein concentration, you should always look for another etiology. It may not be IIH. You may be dealing with something more sinister. All right. Coming to ophthalmic investigations, always these patients must undergo visual field charting, preferably a formal perimetry. With quantification, you need to do a fundus to rule out other causes of papilledema. You may need to do an ultrasound, B scan to rule out other causes. OCT, I'll just spend a second on OCT. See, what OCT does is it tells you about the layers of the retina. So what has been found out is the severity of the papilledema is parallel to the retinal nerve fiber layer thickness. So you can quantify it, especially in follow-up, whether the papilledema is actually resolving or not. Okay. Okay, now coming to management, I'll just spend a couple of minutes. Again, whenever you write management in your answer, you should always write what is the goal of management. So first, our goal of management is always and always to preserve visual function. If you cannot preserve visual function, we have failed to do justice to the patient. So preserve visual function. Second is obviously to alleviate the symptoms. And third, this is a point which I like to highlight. Treat the comorbidities, because most of our patients with IIH, they have PCOD, they have anxiety, depression, they have sleep apnea, and they have cognitive dysfunction. So you can improve their quality of life by treating these disorders, which are independent of the pathophysiology of IIH. Remember, always look for PCOD, anxiety, depression, sleep apnea, and cognitive dysfunction in patients of IIH. Now coming to treatment, we have three types of treatment. One is lifestyle intervention, that is weight loss. You know it is common in obese patients. Second is medical therapy, and third is surgical. So what do you do in lifestyle? You reduce the weight. So I think if you put in this data, your examiner is going to be impressed because he knows what you're talking. You're not talking in broad terms about weight reduction. Remember this low calorie diet, that is 400 kilocalorie per day with low salt diet for at least 3 months along with exercise. This is more than enough. Just for reinforcing the point, if your BMI can reduce by more than 3.5%, it will reduce the CSF more. So your target is reduction of 3.5% or more of the BMI. And it is also helping in modifying the disease, underlying disease process. 400 kilocalorie per day for at least 3 months. Second, bariatric surgery. Not everybody can undergo a bariatric surgery, but it has been shown to be highly effective. Now, what is it shown is 92% of the patients who underwent bariatric surgery, they had reported resolutions of IIH symptoms and ICP reduced by an average of 25 centimeter of water. We all know bariatric surgery has its own complications. So be very careful before you advise it to them. Coming to medical therapy, this is a very important slide. I'll just spend a little, a minute or so here. So acetazolamide is our cornerstone of therapy. Remember this, if it is a mild vision loss, all right, which I'll tell you what is later, you can go up to 500 to 1000 milligram per day. But there are reports that you may even need to go up to 2000 milligram two times a day. Now, that is not a practical dose. These are case reports. But obviously, each one of us has given up to 1000 milligram per day. And some reports have shown that up to 2000 milligram BD also. Important things to remember, it causes paresthesia, dysgeusia, nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea. Topiramate. Now, topiramate is important because it is an additional advantage of weight loss. Okay, you can go up to 100 milligram two times a day. If the patient has too much of side effects of cognition and other issues with topiramate, remember, you have an alternative of zonisamide. All right. Always remember before starting topiramate, look and ask for angle closure glaucoma history and past history of renal stones. They have to drink a lot of water. Remember to tell them. And third is furosemide. You can give it for a synergistic effect. Just to keep a watch on the electrolytes of the patient. And coming last to a very controversial topic of steroids. Now, it has been said that steroids can cause IIH or steroid withdrawal can cause IIH. What they have suggested is if you have a patient of fulminant IIH, wherein he's rapidly losing vision. As I told you in the terminology, if he's rapidly losing vision, you need to give high-dose IV corticosteroids while you are planning the next therapy. All right. Now, in brief, what do you do about the headache? Remember, 68% of headache is similar to migraine. So you do all that you do for migraine, and you can give indomethacin because it has a reduction, it causes reduction in ICP. Important is do not give opioids to patients of headache with IIH. And acetazolamide and lumbar puncture is not recommended for treatment of headache. It may be recommended for reduction in raised ICP or vision, but it is not recommended for headache. So remember these important points. Indomethacin, drug of choice. IIH headache is similar to migraine. So you need to do all that you do for migraine. Avoid medication overuse headache and do not give opioids. Surgical therapy, we all know CSF shunting. Best is lumbar puncture. Okay. When the patient has a fulminant presentation or he does not improve on medical therapy, then you need to go ahead and do a surgical therapy. What is the surgical therapy? You do a CSF shunting. A simple thing is lumbar puncture, low complications. If he does not respond, then you can go for VP shunting or LP shunting. But these have their own complications and almost 50% have a recurrence after 36 months. A brief word about optic nerve sheath fenestration. When the patient's vision is at risk, then you need to do it. And it can improve the symptoms immediately and save the vision, especially in vision. You cannot do it only for headache, but when vision is impaired, you need to do, you can consider ONSF. There are obviously complications, surgical, which you need to explain to the patient, such as a trauma to the optic nerve. It has been shown when you have a transverse venous sinus stenosis and you have a pressure gradient of more than 8, then you can go in for stenting. And these patients have a significant reduction in the CSF pressure. Only if the gradient is more than 8 for patients with IIH who have transverse venous sinus stenosis. So how to choose the best surgical option? In one slide, if it is papilledema, vision loss, but no other symptoms of raised ICP, you go ahead with optic nerve sheath fenestration. If the patient has severe headache along with raised ICP such as sixth nerve palsy, then you consider shunting. So this is how you choose between the two therapies. So this is the summary of management. It depends on severity of vision loss. It depends on severity of papilledema. It depends on the severity of symptoms. It depends on the response to medical therapy, and it depends on the ability to tolerate medical therapy. Okay. So this is the last slide for if you want to note it down. When you have a minimal vision loss, I told you, you can quantify visual field in MD, quantities of MD. So when the visual field loss is very less than -3, you just need to give the patient weight loss and medical therapy. If the vision loss is slightly more, let's say -3 to -7, this is quantified on a perimetry, then you need to go for both, like vision weight loss plus medical therapy. If it is moderate, which means going more higher, now you need to go into weight loss plus aggressive MT, which means 2 or 3 drugs, and plus or minus surgical intervention. Now that depends on how much your patient is responding to medical therapy. And finally, when your patient has a severe vision loss, you need to throw the kitchen sink at the patient. You need to give everything that you have: weight loss, aggressive medical therapy, surgical intervention. The only thing is the timing, when to do it. It is still controversial, but if your patient is not responding to medical therapy, you need to go ahead and save his vision. So a brief word about pregnancy: do not use topiramate in pregnancy. You can do LP if the patient of pregnancy with IIH has a risk of vision loss, and you can do other surgical techniques such as optic nerve sheath fenestration, but do not use topiramate, and there is no recommendation of acetazolamide, so we still don't know. Finally, visual prognosis is good. Headache is a poor prognostic factor. If the patient is male or with early onset vision loss and black ethnic origin, the vision loss is more severe. And patients who have a high ICP, they somehow have a good prognosis because it is said that they come earlier to the doctor. So their vision tends to get saved. So follow-up is usually, if it is a rapid case or fulminant, you follow him within 1 to 3 weeks. Mild cases, you can follow up between 1 to 3 months. Newer therapies, for those who want to score extra marks, you can use octreotide, has been tried, but more studies are still needed. And there are trials going on in weight loss strategies and bariatric surgery. So this is a slide of what you can read. Differentiating papilledema from pseudopapilledema, severity of papilledema, what is prison scale, what are the false localizing signs in raised ICP, and what are the falsely high recording, how you can get a falsely high recording of CSF opening pressure, and when to suspect CVT in a patient with IIH. Some people may want to read the trial as well. So I'll conclude with that. This is the further reading, and I'm sorry if I exceeded my time. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Batra. Again, a very extensive and all covering kind of a presentation. Very nice. I think you covered everything that is required, both for the students as well as for the practitioners. Let's move on to our next talk with Dr. Amit Pandey, who is going to talk about SIH. And he's done his DM from Bombay Hospital. And he is our young, dynamic neurologist from my company and always interested in academics. I hand over the mic to Amit. Amit, let's begin.
Yes. Good evening, all. Thank you, sir, for the kind words. And I also like to thank the Fine Forum for giving this opportunity. And it is a greatly useful exercise for the upcoming neurologists. So my topic right now, after raised intracranial pressure, idiopathic intracranial hypertension, as well as trigeminal autonomic cephalalgias, is spontaneous intracranial hypotension. So as laid out by previous two speakers, and my the scope of the answer would be in the same way: introduction. How do you write? Start with the introduction. Clinical features.
Amit, have you shared your screen?
Yes, sir, I have.
Okay.
It's
not shared.
It's not shared.
Not shared.
Okay. So is it visible now?
No. Yeah. Now it's starting.
So it's okay now?
It's started, but it's yet to begin. Ah, now. Yes. Okay. Now make it full screen. Yep. Okay. Go ahead.
So yes, the topic of discussion, I'll start now, sir.
Yes, go ahead, please.
Yes, the topic of discussion, a short note, is spontaneous intracranial hypotension. So we will cover this topic under the following: clinical features, diagnostic criteria, causes and predisposing factors, differential diagnosis, investigations, and treatment. So what is spontaneous intracranial hypotension? It is a misnomer because it is never spontaneous. So majority of them have a preceding event. Symptoms and signs are intracranial, but pathology is majority of the times extracranial. Hypotension is a word, but sometimes the CSF pressure is not less than 60 millimeters. It is essentially a low CSF volume, low CSF pressure, and low compliance of the spinal dura. We often, as residents, mistake postdural puncture hypotension as SIH, which is not to be done. We'll discuss about it later. So what do patients come up with? The clinical features, as mentioned here, they are SIH is mostly seen in females from 4th to 5th decade of life. The most prominent feature of this is headache, which is sudden or gradual. Majority of them have headaches on sitting and standing. It is throbbing or dull aching occasionally, and the classical feature is it is relieved on recumbency. The patient says he starts having headache when he's sitting or standing, and when he lies down, he's all right. These headaches are exacerbated by head movement, coughing, straining, sneezing, and occasionally jugular venous compressions. These headaches may sometimes have intermittent nature to them. As the duration of the disease increases, later on, the disease may be similar to a chronic daily headache, and we have also seen erysipelagic patients coming with SIH. What are the other features which we see? Neck pain or stiffness, nausea and vomiting is rarely seen. Other rare symptoms with which the patient presents are vertigo, blurred vision, hiccups, dysgeusia, and transient visual obscurations. Occasionally, cognitive and behavioral changes are also seen. So how do you diagnose SIH? Of course, there is a set of diagnostic criteria. This is taken from the continuum. You need to demonstrate a presence of spinal CSF leak, extrathecal CSF, or there should be changes of intracranial hypotension on the cranial MRI, that is subdural fluid collection, enhancement of pachymeninges, or sagging of the brain, and the presence of at least one of the following. The opening pressure, as mentioned, should be low. There should be evidence of spinal meningeal diverticulum, and there should be improvement of symptoms after epidural blood patching. Or if the criteria A and B are not met, then the presence of all of the following, or at least two if typical orthostatic headaches are present. Low opening pressure, spinal meningeal symptoms, and improvement of symptoms after epidural blood patching. So you have to remember that these diagnostic criteria are essential for diagnosing. We quickly move to the causes. As mentioned, they are seen in patients who are thin patients, as well as patients suffering from connective tissue diseases, marfanoid, Ehlers-Danlos-like, degenerative disc disease patients, patients who are having excessive joint hypermobility, in spine disorders like patients with calcified herniated discs, osteophytes and spondylotic spurs, and a CSF venous fistula. Trauma is also known to be a predisposing factor for spontaneous intracranial hypotension, especially if the patient has undergone a previous spine surgery. There is a history of lumbar puncture. There are nerve root avulsions and accidents. There is history of previous spinal or epidural anesthesia or trivial traumas. Bariatric surgeries have also known to precipitate SIH. Often postdural puncture hypotension is confused with SIH. It is erroneous to call it SIH, as it is not spontaneous. It is very low down and it is easily cured conservatively. So postdural puncture headache is not SIH. Also, spontaneous leaks through the thin cribriform plate, which are rarely seen, are seen post-trauma. So the important fact is about the pathophysiology. We all know about the Monroe-Kelly hypothesis, which states that at any given point, CSF volume plus blood volume plus brain volume in the brain is always constant. What essentially happens in SIH? You lose CSF. as the arterial blood and the brain volume are going to remain the same, the excess volume is compensated by the venous blood. So you see evidence of venous congestion in these cases. This can be a simple diagram which you can use during your examinations to convey your point. You should know the differential diagnosis, and they have already been discussed in the previous two discussions. So the differential diagnosis mainly are a primary headache, a pseudotumor cerebri, and other causes of thunderclap headache. So how do you differentiate them? As already discussed, the orthostatic feature of intracranial hypotension, that is worse on sitting up or standing, is a classical feature. In cases of pseudotumor cerebri, it is worse on lying, and in cases of primary headache, it varies. The location of pseudotumor headaches in pseudotumor cerebri is bifrontal. In cases of intracranial hypotension, it is mostly occipital. Papilledema, as Dr. Dhruv discussed, is present in cases of pseudotumor cerebri. It is rarely seen in cases of intracranial hypotension. The body habitus in pseudotumor cerebri is obese and very thin or frail in cases of intracranial hypotension. You have empty cella in cases of pseudotumor cerebri, normal MRI in primary headaches, and hyperemia or enlarged pituitary in cases of intracranial hypotension. The LP pressure is high in cases of pseudotumor cerebri. It may remain low or normal in case of intracranial hypotension. So these are few points which you can use to highlight the differential diagnosis. So moving on to investigations. Whenever a patient with headaches, that is postural, comes to the casualty, the first investigation, which is if readily available, is a CT scan. So in a CT scan, what do you see? You see a thin subdural collection. You can see here clearly a thin rim of subdural collection bilaterally. You could also see acquired tonsillar ectopia, the tonsillar herniation, crowding of the posterior cranial fossa. And there is dural venous distension. So on CT scan, you can make up this much. So this can give you a clear sign that there are chances of the patient may be suffering from spontaneous intracranial hypotension. What do you see in MRI? For smart people, smart students, there are qualitative signs on MRI. Pachymeningeal enhancement, which resolves with duration. As long as the duration of the disease increases, this enhancement goes on receding. Increased blood volume, which is well demarcated by the venous distension sign. The cross-section of the venous system is rounded. Occasionally, you also see cerebral venous sinus thrombosis. You may see enlargement of the pituitary. There will be subdural effusions or hematoma. There may be diffuse cerebral edema, reduced CSF volume as manifested by cerebellar tonsillar descent, sagging brainstem, decreased fluid in optic nerve sheath. Extra smart students may use quantitative signs as well to get some brownie points. The mammillopontine distance less than 5.5 millimeters, the pontomesencephalic angle less than 50 degrees, the interpeduncular angle less than 40.5 degrees. Now these are only numbers. These are more useful in radiology, but in exams you can just write them down and get extra brownie points. But the super smart students just spell the simple mnemonic SEEPS. You see a subdural collection bilaterally. The enhancement of pachymeninges. You can see here clearly, the dura is enhanced. So this enhancement is for E. You may see engorgement of the venous sinuses. When you classically see this, this could look like an Eiffel Tower. So I call it the Eiffel Tower sign. So when you see this, you should think about spontaneous intracranial hypotension. Pituitary hyperemia. You see the pituitary, it is enlarged and hyperemic. And sagging of the brain. Sagging of the brain showing crowding of the posterior fossa and flattening of the pontine belly. Also, you could see the corpus callosum coming down. Okay. So this is the MRI brain imaging. This is what you can write. The spinal imaging may help us in identifying the site, nature of leak, and cause to plan therapy. You may see meningeal diverticulas due to osteophytes, disc protrusions, mostly lower in cervical or thoracic. You can use CT myelography after intrathecal contrast for detecting fast leaks. For slow leaks, you may use MRI myelography. Radionuclide scintigraphy is not useful for diagnosis, but it may help you to localize. So this is a spinal MRI imaging, which shows pachymeningeal enhancement of the cervical cord in this region in the figure A. There are dilated nerve root sleeves on gadolinium myelography. There is epidural extravasation on T2 axial scans here. There is engorgement of the venous plexus down in the lumbar region. In images E and F, you see elongated extraarachnoid fluid collections at various spinal levels. You could see the elongated collection of fluids here and the anteriorly. You can use a CT myelogram to demonstrate the osteophytes and spurs. Here you see a classical osteophyte. Here you again see one osteophyte. You can do a delayed CT myelogram. This shows a dorsal spur, and these are causes of spontaneous intracranial hypotension. A MR myelogram for slow leaks may show an osteophyte and the site of leak. And this is a heavily T2 weighted axial MRI showing meningeal diverticulum, and hyperdynamic CT myelo showing the this diverticulum to be leaking. So moving on to treatment. Treatment is of two types. First of all, conservative, in which bed rest is the most important thing. You have to elevate the foot end of the bed, that is the Trendelenburg position. Can use caffeine, theophylline, and abdominal binders. Analgesics, corticosteroids, or overhydration. After 4 to 6 weeks of time, most of these patients are asymptomatic. Intervention is required when symptoms recur or they don't go away. Epidural blood patch is the treatment of choice. Autologous high volume blood patch has got a success rate of 30%. Can be done by pre-medicating acetazolamide to decrease CSF and instilling high volume blood, which is done in the amount of 10 to 20 ml initially. Surgery is used occasionally, and it involves ligation or clipping of meningeal diverticula. Larger dural defects can be closed with a muscle or fat plaget with gelatin sponge and fibrin sealant or suture. Lumbar dural reduction surgery may sometimes be needed. Relief of headaches after the epidural blood patch is itself diagnostic in a few cases. This is a very simple algorithm in managing SIH. If you suspect a CSF leak, do a head MRI, contrast enhancement required. Spine MRI, contrast enhancement not required. If it is positive, do a lumbar epidural blood patch. No more adequate relief. Repeat an epidural blood patch, lumbar or bilevel. If there is no relief, do a CT myelo and identify the site of leak. Targeted epidural blood patch, single or many times, or may require surgery. If there is a rapid flow leak, do a dynamic CT myelography or its variants, the digital subtraction myelography. Identify the site of leak and do an epidural blood patch. If a slow flow leak is detected, do a delayed CT myelography and a gadolinium myelography. And if no leak is identified, recheck in 4 to 6 months. If the head or spine MRI is negative and the clinical index of suspicion is strong, do a radioisotope cisternography. If it is positive, repeat an epidural blood patch. If it is negative, consider other etiology. So I have used these references for preparation of this presentation. I'd like to wish best to the upcoming students for their examination. And what I used during my PG practice, I used this Draw It to Know It from the YouTube. It is a good set of neural anatomy structures and figures which help you memorize lots of circuits and tracks. And it helps you in your clinical practice as well. I hope you all benefit from this. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Pandey. Very nice talk. I think you also managed to everything. I think let's move on to the last talk of today, which is RCVS by Dr. Dubeirkar, who's passed his DIM neurology from Chandigarh and is one of the fastest neurologists in our neurology group and will give us a cross-reference within probably seconds to minutes. Always involved in any discussion. Off to you, Dr. Dubeirkar.
Reversible cerebral vasoconstriction syndrome, it's a clinical and radiological syndrome. Remember, it's clinical as well as radiological both. Clinically, it is characterized by hyperacute onset of severe headache and radiologically by segmental vasoconstriction of cerebral arteries. And most importantly, that vasoconstriction should resolve within 3 months. So that is RCVS. It is not a single disease entity, but should be considered a common presentation of multiple disorders characterized by reversible vasoconstriction. In the older days, it was called by many names like Colfeving syndrome, thunderclap headache, postpartum angiography. These are some of the terms which were used, like migraineous vasospasm, benign angiopathy of the central nervous system, postpartum angiopathy. All these entities are now lumped in together with RCVS, that is reversible cerebral vasoconstriction syndrome. Now coming to the epidemiology and triggers, that it is common in middle age group around 20 to 50. Females are more commonly affected. There is no racial or ethnic predisposition. It is in around half patients. It is idiopathic. That means there is no cause. But there are certain triggers which are there, like physical exertion, bathing, acute stressful or emotional situation, orgasm, coughing, aircraft descent. These may not be causative, but at the onset, people have noticed these triggers which produce their symptoms. The secondary causes I will show you in table, but remember, 3 most common causes of RCVS are vasoactive drugs, postpartum state, and migraine. These are the 3 most common associations of RCVS. Coming to the secondary causes of RCVS, vasoactive substance, recreational drugs, cannabis, cocaine, amphetamine, LSD, sympathomimetic agents, nasal decongestants, special mention about SSRIs and triptans. These are associated with RCVS. Then, if we see some of the drugs like tacrolimus, cyclophosphamide, blood products, erythropoietin, IVIG, red cell transfusion, these are also notorious for producing posterior reversible leukoencephalopathy or PRESS. There is significant overlap between this entity and PRESS. We will see PRESS is one of the manifestations of RCVS. Now, what are other predisposing conditions? Pregnancy, eclampsia, preeclampsia. It is associated with certain neoplasm like pheochromocytoma, hypercalcemia, and porphyria. It is also associated with RCVS. Now, what is the pathogenesis? The single most important thing in pathogenesis is there is alteration in cerebral vascular tone leading to vasoconstriction, which leads to loss of autoregulation. So this vasoconstriction is either because of sympathetic overactivity, endothelial dysfunction, and oxidative stress. Association with increase in blood pressure, ingestion of sympathomimetic drugs, and pheochromocytoma supports that there is a sympathetic overactivity producing vasoconstriction. There is a significant overlap between RCVS and PRESS, which suggests there is an importance of endothelial dysfunction, which leads to vasoconstriction. As I said, RCVS is a common endpoint of diverse group of disease process, as it is a clinical and radiological. So in simple slide, in a genetically predisposed individual, precipitating factors like vasoactive substance, triggers, pregnancy, or puerperium, there is either sympathetic overactivity, endothelial dysfunction, which leads to reactive blood pressure surges leading to thunderclap headache, vasoconstriction. Because of endothelial dysfunction, there is autoregulation breakdown, which leads to PRESS-like changes. And because of vasoconstriction, there is watershed ischemia. Because watershed infarcts, later on we'll see in radiology, are hallmarks in RCVS. So coming to the diagnostic criteria, what is the diagnostic criteria for RCVS? Headaches can be recurrent up to 1 month with thunderclap onset. Thunderclap headache is the hallmark of RCVS. With or without additional neurological signs, that means sometimes headaches can be the only manifestation. It is usually uniphasic disease course with no new symptoms after 1 month, which is very important. After 1 month, RCVS does not have any other symptoms, which is important in differentiating from CNS vasculitis or other pathologies. There is no evidence of aneurysmal SH. In radiology, I will tell you what is the difference between aneurysmal SH and SH in RCVS. If we do CSF analysis, it is near normal, very important. Protein levels are less than 80, cell count is usually less than 10, and there is a normal glucose level. Important again to differentiate from infective etiology, inflammatory etiology, and CNS vasculitis. So CSF should be essentially normal. And if you do radiologically, you must be able to demonstrate multifocal segmental cerebral artery vasoconstriction. You can use either CT angiography, MRI angiography, or DSA. And the most importantly, there should be reversibility of all these angiographic abnormalities within 12 weeks of onset. If the death occurs, postmortem should rule out other causes like vasculitis or other differential diagnosis of RCVS. Now coming to the symptomatology and thunderclap headaches. This is important. You must know about thunderclap headache. What is thunderclap headache is that it is severe throbbing headache that reaches its intensity within 60 seconds of onset. And on visual analog scale, it should be more than 7. It should score more than 7. So anything which peaks within a minute is thunderclap headache. It's like thunderbolt in the sky. So RCVS pain is often bilateral, diffuse, can originate in occipital region like subarachnoid hemorrhage. Thunderclap headaches are present in up to 95 to 100% patient and can be sole manifestation as a presenting symptom in around 3/4 of cases. There is often delay between onset of headache and presentation. So that delay is around 7 days. It can be associated with other signs like nausea, vomiting, diplopia, elevation in blood pressure, photosensitivity. If in case of migraine, thunderclap headaches occur, they are usually different from their usual quantity, their usual location and severity. That means degree of pain. So even in migraine patient, if it occurs, you will have different kinds of headache at the onset of this RCVS. Now, what are other clinical presentations and events? I have underlined the important thing. You can, when writing exam, you can use these words underlined because you will show examiner that you have understood. You know the crux of these underlined words. So other symptoms, seizures can be presentation, altered sensorium or encephalopathy, focal neurological deficits, transient ischemic attacks, ischemic stroke, intracranial hemorrhages, edema and press. All can be presentations of RCVS. In terms of focal neurological deficit, like PRACE, we can have visual deficit. Some patients manifest with hemiplegia, dysarthria, aphasia, sensory symptoms, and ataxia. But what is more common is a subarachnoid hemorrhage or in RCVS. What is more important is that it is focal and localized to superficial cerebral sulci near cerebral convexities. Now, this is an important point because if you have aneurysmal SH, it is usually more common in the sylvian fissures. And then around the cisterns, you can see, okay? But here in RCVS, usually the subarachnoid hemorrhage is focal and localized in superficial cerebral sulci because the pile vessels are actually ruptured. So that produces subarachnoid hemorrhage. When we will come to radiology, I will show where exactly they are localized. Now, other intracranial hemorrhages which can occur is parenchymal hemorrhage in around 5 to 20% of patients. They are usually unifocal and lobar, unlike hypertensive patients. So, and rarely in RCVS, you can have subdural hemorrhage. The hemorrhagic complications and concomitant press and seizures, they are more common during the first week of illness. While the ischemic events like TIA or ischemic stroke-like presentation is common in after first week. So in RCVS, remember hemorrhagic complication in first weeks, while ischemic complications are common after first week. Now coming to the diagnosis, and we have got multimodal imaging availability, but whatever modality is available, each modality has got different role. What is the role of TCD? TCD is useful in terms of diagnosis of vasoconstriction and monitoring of vasoconstriction. So increasing flick flow velocities are going to indicate us that vasoconstriction is setting in. There is a Lindard index which we can use. If it is more than 3, then it is suggestive of vasospasm. doing CT angiography, as you have done most of the time, you can do in an emergency CT scan and CT angiography. It can help us in demonstrating of cerebral vasospasm. And second thing, it can rule out aneurysm. MRI and MR angiography, same like CT scan, but additional thing which is there is vessel wall imaging in MR angiography. The vessel wall imaging is a different technique than routine angiography. Here, what it is called as blood black technique, where we can actually see the vessel. In all the other angiographies, we are seeing the blood flowing through the vessel wall. But here we are seeing vessel wall, not the blood. And what is the important thing is that in RCVS, the vessel wall is usually normal. While in CNS vasculitis, there may be significant enhancement of that vessel wall. That is an important point, because in RCVS, we know there is no inflammation. It is just a vasoconstriction. While in CNS vasculitis, it is an inflammation of the vessel wall. Finally, the catheter angiography or the DSA. The DSA is a gold standard for demonstration of vasospasm as well as resolution of vasospasm. There is another role of DSA, especially in severe cases where there is severe vasoconstriction producing a life-threatening complication. We can either give intra-arterial vasodilator drugs or we can do balloon angioplasty. So every modality has got different indication. Whatever is availability, we can best use that modality in a patient. So this is a radiological spectrum of RCVS. Just look at the first A diagram where you can see there is a subarachnoid hemorrhage, and look at the location. It is cortical. It is usually in the cortical area. And if you see usually the subarachnoid hemorrhage, this is the Sylvian fissure. Here the fissures or the cisterns where it is maximum. But here it is located in the cortical area. Sometimes the thrombocortical vein can be a differential diagnosis in this setting. Now coming to the hemorrhage, this is the lobar hemorrhage which we characteristically see. And then there is a press or other ischemic complications. And if we see the vessel wall imaging or the MR angiography, we can see there is a significant vasoconstriction. Remember here, medium and large vessels are involved. So it is very easy to see vasospasm. The medium and large size arteries are usually involved in this case. And it gives appearance like a sausage-like appearance is there on the, if you do DSA. So that is what is the imaging features of RCVS. Now this is a typical case of CNS vasculitis. In CNS vasculitis, usually it is subacute to chronic, basically. The course is more than 1 month. Headaches are gradually increasing. Infarcts are of varying size. And if you do angiography, then in angiography, it's actually dirty looking like picture is there. We'll see in differential diagnosis. But if you see here in CNS vasculitis, usually the large and small vessels, both can be involved, unlike with what we saw in RCVS. Then there is a ectasia. Ectasia, that means dilatation also is there, which is not seen in RCVS. RCVS only vasoconstriction. Here we can see dilatation or ectasia is also seen. So coming to the differential diagnosis, these are the three differential diagnoses which are important. RCVS, onset is with thunderclap headaches. In CNS vasculitis is usually insidious or chronic. SAH, again, thunderclap headaches can be there. Infarct pattern in RCVS is watershed. While in CNS vasculitis, they are small, scattered, and different age infarcts are seen. In subarachnoid hemorrhage in RCVS is small cortical. In CNS vasculitis, we rarely see subarachnoid hemorrhage. While in SAH, it is in fissures and in the cisterns, and it is dense sometimes. Lobar hemorrhage are common in RCVS. If we see hemorrhage in subarachnoid hemorrhage, it is usually along the, if in, it's in ACA related, along the gyrus recti, or it is along the Sylvian fissure if it is around the MCA distribution. So we will never not see parenchymal hemorrhages per se. Reversible edema, it's common in RCVS. It is very rare in CNS vasculitis and not seen in subarachnoid hemorrhage. In angiogram, we see sausage on a string. That means it is a smooth, and sausage is, string is a vasoconstricted area. In CNS vasculitis, it is irregular, notched, and the vessels are ectatic. While in subarachnoid hemorrhage, if we see DSA, there will be aneurysm. So this is how we differentiate. There is another thing which is there, how to differentiate it from other entities. And there is a score called as RCVS2 score. What is it? If there is a recurrent, it is on -2, scale of -2 to +10. If there is a recurrent or single thunderclap headaches, more in favor of RCVS. If there are vasoconstrictive trigger, again, favors more of. Carotid artery involvement, again, more in favor of RCVS. 6, that means if more common in females, and if you see subcortical subarachnoid hemorrhage, then it is again more in favor of. So if this score is 5 or more, it is definitely going to tell us that RCVS is a very strong possibility. But if the score is on the lower side, then we can say definitely it is not a RCVS. So RCVS 2 score can be used bedside just to confirm whether we are dealing with RCVS like situation or we are dealing something away from the RCVS. Now coming to the laboratory evaluation, routine lab tests and vasculitic markers are usually normal. Serum and urine toxicology screen, for if patient has got history of recreational drugs, then we can do that. Plasma metanephrines and urinary catecholamines, especially any patient has presented with the significant elevated blood pressure on presentation, that should be done. CSF analysis, usually we do to rule out SH, infection or other inflammation. As I said, CSF is usually normal in RCVS. There is no role for brain or temporal lobe, temporal artery biopsies in this patient. Now coming to the most important part, how are we going to treat the patient of RCVS? Once we have seen clinically, it is fitting into RCVS. Radiologically, there is RCVS. Now it is coming to the treatment. So there is no randomized controlled trial to treat RCVS, but there are certain guidelines from case series. These are the guidelines. What is more important is that identification and withdrawal of precipitating vasoactive agents, avoidance of headache triggers, adequate analgesia, bed rest, and good observation, because patients can worsen. Majority have self-limited course. Majority will have self-limited course. They will do better. Mortality is very less. Symptomatic treatment of headache with simple analgesic, including paracetamol and opioid, is recommended. But important point is that indomethacin and triptan should be avoided, as they may exacerbate the cause. Triptans, as I said, are associated with RCVS. Antiepileptic drugs are required for symptomatic seizures, but they are never required for long-term basis. Maximum we can give it for 8 to 12 weeks. But long-term, usually antiepileptics are not required. Then those patients who have got severe course or those with a poor Glasgow Coma Scale, they can be monitored with ICU. Good blood pressure management is equally important. Those who have ischemic stroke or hemorrhagic stroke, we can guide manage their blood pressure as per the stroke guidelines. Then what is the drug which is useful? It's calcium channel antagonists. They are the most commonly used drugs. And out of that, nimodipine is the most preferred drug. We can give it either orally. If available IV, we can use IV. Verapamil and nicardipine are other drugs that can be used. The recommended dose of oral nimodipine is 30 to 60 milligram per 4 hours. Then in patients who are actually having severe course, we can use infusion of nimodipine 1 to 2 milligram per hour, titrated according to blood pressure. Those patients who have got severe vasospasm, those who have severe hemorrhagic manifestation or severe press, then in those situations, we can use IV nimodipine. What is the duration of treatment? Depending upon what is the patient's status, we can use it around 4 to 8 weeks. It is not generally, any treatment is not required more than that. And as I said, if any patient has got severe vasospasm, especially involving the large vessels, and in that situation, we can either give intra-arterial nicardipine or we can do balloon angioplasty. Most important point is that there is no role of steroids. It actually can worsen the RCVS. So do not try. If you're suspecting RCVS, do not give empirical steroids. You are going to worsen the situation. Okay. Sorry, I can't move my slide. Hello.
Hello. Yes.
Yeah. Sorry. Yeah, I got it. So, sorry, sir.
Yeah.
It got stuck actually. Now I can't see my screen also.
Okay, yeah. What I will do is I'll stop sharing your slide.
Now I can see this. There's only one slide which is remaining.
Your network.
Yeah, I got it. Yeah.
Yeah, so you can share your
slide. Share your screen again.
Yeah, share the screen again.
You can see my slide?
No, not yet.
Not yet.
I will share it again.
Yes.
Now it is visible?
Yes.
Coming. Yeah.
Yes.
So prognosis, as I said, it is a self-limiting monophasic course with usual recovery by 4 weeks. Only around 5 to 10% patient will have fulminant course, especially in postpartum period. RCVS, as I said, is a clinical entity, neurological emergency, and it is now increasingly diagnosed because of availability of the imaging modalities, high index of suspicion. Characteristic feature in history and on neuroimaging are distinctive, but there is a significant overlap between PRESS. So we have to carefully weigh the diagnosis, but anyway, both are managed relatively same way. And then there are certain areas of future research where there are gray areas is pathogenesis, which is not very clear. Then what is the optimal diagnostic strategy and further treatment modalities. So these are the areas any student interested in research, these are the things where they can look into. So I hope I have made everything clear. And these are the 4 articles where I have prepared my slides. Out of that, RCVS from AJNR, that is American Journal of Neuroradiology, there are 2 parts. I think that is an excellent review. You will get everything, every doubt will be cleared about it. Then there is one article in Therapeutic Advances in Neurological Disorder on RCVS. And if you are interested, that Dr. Anish Singhal sir's son, has got maximum work from MGH on reversible RCVS. There is a nice presentation in PowerPoint by Anish Singhal sir. You can go through that. But I think the slides are sufficient. If you want to read extra, these are the things which you can read. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Duberkar. I think you also managed to cover almost everything. You've not spared anything. Very good. The sessions went on a bit longer than we expected, but most of the speakers managed to do an extensive review of literature and cover points in elaborate detail. I hope all the students have found it useful. There are a few questions remaining. Can we use beta blocker in RCVS, Dr. Duberkar?
Beta blockers? Not required. Basically, if for management of blood pressure control, if patient is already on beta blockers, then yeah, can be used. But
absolutely not as direct management for RCVS as such. And RCVS presenting as acute ischemic stroke. What is the take on thrombolysis in window?
The foremost thing is that thunderclap headaches at the onset is a red flag in any stroke, if there are thunderclap headaches. Other thing is that ischemic complications are, as I said, common in second week, not in the first week. First week, you will have hemorrhagic complications or press-like presentation, which is common. But yes, if there is a stroke mimic, people have thrombolyzed them without any significant side effect. So if there is significant dilemma and if you do not have angiographic facility, there is no harm, but I won't recommend doing that without a proper diagnosis.
Absolutely. So if there is a thunderclap headache at the outset and then and the pathogenesis should be thought of before contemplating thrombolysis. It's difficult, I think, if the patient is in window, it could be really difficult call to take. Is RCVS PRESS the same spectrum disorder?
I skipped that slide and that thing, but more people are coming towards that. They are thinking that RCVS and PRESS actually belong to same spectrum of disorder. Except that RCVS, in addition to endothelial dysfunction, there is a significant vasoconstriction which is proven in every case for diagnostic purposes. We do not do angiography in PRESS patients. I think if we start doing angiography, we may see 2 patients having vasoconstriction on that. Possible, they are same spectrum disorder.
Absolutely. Impaired cerebral autoregulation and sort of change in the vasomotor tone, I think, is a factor common for both vascular tone. Yes, agreed. I think that's all the questions were, and many other questions that came on during the process, during the lecture sessions, we already answered many of them. So I think we've extended time today a little bit, but managed to cover topic more exhaustively in today's session. Kothari sir, you want to say something?
I have one thing is somebody's asked, can you, what about conception in IIH? Obviously, unless the IIH is treated and the pressure is got down, I don't think the person should conceive.
Absolutely.
But it's dangerous. I mean, first get it treated. I wanted to ask Dhruv Patra about weight, the diet. Is he there? Because 400 calories is, I'm not sure, is that really the guideline? 400 calories per day is torture for 3 months.
Yeah, sir, that's what the Lancet Neurology article says. I know it's, I think, practically pretty difficult to do it.
No, but, because low calorie is defined as less than 800. 400 will be to continue for 3 months.
Yeah, so I think that's a part of the trial. So obviously, these are not practical conditions. So what they've done is, as a part of the trial, they put people on this diet for 3 months. And it said that if your BMI can come down by 3.5%, then you will have a significant improvement purely on lifestyle measures. Now, obviously, we would be giving medical therapy to these patients as well. So we may not need that strict a diet. I mean, this is talking purely in terms of lifestyle therapy.
Okay. The important point is that many patients do improve only with little weight loss. You don't have to lose a lot of weight, just a little weight loss, and it tips the balance. And many times the IIH recovers with just little weight loss. So you must insist on weight loss, and it doesn't have to be a major weight loss. Sometimes even a little weight loss and they recover. I wanted to know why sixth nerve palsy is so uncommon. I mean, generally, when we say raised ICT, we talk about false localizing value and sixth nerve palsy.
Sixth nerve is the commonest.
So why is it so uncommon in IIH? You are putting it as the last symptom in IIH. So I want to know, do you get tinnitus and the other symptoms of IIH in other causes of raised ICT, or is IIH somehow different?
Sir, what they've said is that I mean this is based on most of the times I think patients don't come with those symptoms. What I put the percentages was what the symptoms the patient presents with. So if the patient himself, if he complains of diplopia or something, that is much less frequent as compared to the other symptoms. So it was that is what they have done. That is the symptoms.
Okay.
So I think maybe if we put a science, maybe it will be much higher.
Okay. Great job, all of you. Very good, Sripad. Keep it up. And I think
very nice.
Forward to the next one. Keep it up.
Yes.
Bye.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.